Hello friends, welcome you all. Today we are going to discuss an important prelims question that is based on current affairs in the month of January 2020. Let us begin with question number 1. Which of the following statement is or are correct regarding Andhra's concept of three capital? Statement number 1. Andhra Pradesh has decided to make Kurnool as the judicial capital. Statement number 2. The concept of having this three capital is inspired from Kenya. Here one has to know that we have to identify the correct statement. So let us see the statement number 1. Yes, the statement is correct. Andhra Pradesh has decided to make Kurnool as the judicial capital. Therefore, this statement number 1 is right. If you take statement number 2, this statement is wrong. Why it is wrong? Since this concept of having three capital is inspired by South Africa, not based on the Kenya. Instead, it is based on South Africa. One has to remember that. So based on our discussion, answer for the question number 1 is option A, 1 only is the right answer. So let us see few facts related to Andhra Pradesh concept of three capital. Then the Chief Minister Y.S. Jagan Mohan Reddy has hinted that Andhra Pradesh could have three decentralized capital on the lines of South Africa. The new capital being developed at Amaravati and Vishakhapatnam and Kurnool. One has to note that the Amaravati intent could become the legislative capital, and also the port city Vishakhapatnam to become executive capital and Kurnool to become the judicial capital. So these are the important facts related to three capital system. Let us move on with the question number 2. Here we have to consider the following statement regarding Pradhana Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana. So this is very important scheme. See, the government schemes are very important related to prelims perspective. Here we are going to talk about Pradhana Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana. So let us see. Statement number 1. In short, PMMY, it's maternity benefit program implemented in all the districts of the country. And recently, Haryana was awarded the first position in the category of best performer. Statement number 3. It is for the family living child of the only. Statement number 3 is, it is only for the first living child of the family. Here, we have to identify the correct statement. Let us analyze the statement number 1. If you take statement number 1, this statement is right. Since this Pradhana Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana is a maternity benefit program implemented in all the districts of the country. If you take statement number 2, the statement is wrong, incorrect statement. Why statement number 2 is incorrect? Since the best performer in the category of best performance, since inception of this scheme, of states and union territories having the population of more than 1 crore. So based on this, Madhya Pradesh captured, that is, the followed the award of the state of Madhya Pradesh and followed by Andhra Pradesh, and Haryana was in the third position, not in the first position. First one is Madhya Pradesh, second one is Andhra Pradesh, third one is Haryana. And if you take statement number 3, this statement is right. So, the answer for the question number 2 is C, 1 and 3 only is right. And also, you can go by elimination method. Why elimination method? See, 2 is wrong, right? Therefore, you can eliminate D, B and A. Obviously, we will get an answer. C, 1 and 3 is the answer for the question number 2. So, this scheme is very important. We are having about this scheme in the government scheme section. That is separate playlist. Kindly go through that playlist videos for the general scheme. Let us move on with question number 3. Which of the following statement is or are correct regarding 8 wonders of Shanghai Cooperation Organization? That is, in short, SCO. So let us see. That is statement number 1. Statement number 1 is 3 wonders of SCO include archaeological and historical monuments of SEO region. And statement number 2, this statue of unity in India has been added to 8 wonders of Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Yes, if you know about the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, then would come to know that both the statements given here are correct. So anyhow, we are going to identify that about discuss about Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Let us see 8 wonders of Shanghai Cooperation Organization. This Statue of Unity that was inaugurated by the Prime Minister Modi in October 2018. It includes 8 wonders of SEO. The statue was a monumental tribal to Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, and also one has to know that it is world tallest statue. And in 1 year since the inauguration, it attracted 2.9 million tourists and earned 82 crores of rupees. So let us see about 8 wonders. The wonders of SEO includes archaeological and historical monuments of SEO region. It includes Statue of Unity in India and damming places in China and palace in Tajikistan and Mughal heritage in Pakistan and Tomglay George in Kazakhstan and Poyai Kalan complex in Uzbekistan and Golden Ring of Russia and Lahore, that is the Mughal heritage in Pakistan. These are the 8 wonders of SEO. So let us move on with question number 4. Which of the following statement is or are correct regarding Aditya L1? So before identifying the statements, let us know few facts related to this Aditya L1. The scheme, I mean the Indian Space Research Organization, is set to launch first solar mission, that is called as Aditya L1. It will be India's first dedicated scientific mission to study the sun. One has to note here, this mission is to study about the sun. That is very important. Here, this mission aims to put 1500 kg AV class Aditya L1 satellite into halo orbit across Lagrangian point of L1. That is the point between sun and earth. This point is at a distance of about 1.1 million kilometers from Earth. So what are the objectives of this mission? Study dynamic nature of sun's outermost layer, that is corona and chromosomes, and collect data about coronal mass ejections, in short CME. And also to study on origin of solar storms and their path through the interplanetary space from the sun to the Earth. And also to study, these studies will also focus on collection of informations for space weather predictions. So this is the few facts related to Aditya L1. Let us see about statement number 1. This statement is right. Just now we have discussed, therefore the statement 1 is right. If you take statement number 2, this is wrong, since it is not a flagship program of NASA. Instead, it is the flagship program of ISRO. Therefore, statement 2 is wrong. The answer for the question number 4 is A1 only. It's the right answer. Let us move on with question number 5. Here, which of the following statement is or are correct regarding to National Infrastructure Pipeline? See, if you are preparing for prelims 2021, one should know about National Infrastructure Pipeline. This is very important. You may expect question from this topic. Let us see. Statement number 1. It has outlined plans to invest more than rupees 1 or 2 lakhs crores of infrastructure project by 2024 to 2025. And statement number 2. The center, state and private sector will share the capital expenditure in a 50-30-20 formula. Here we have to identify the correct statement. So let us analyze the statements. If you take statement number one, yes, this statement number one is right. Recently, the government has released a report of the task force on national infrastructure pipeline for 2019-2025. The earlier, the Prime Minister in his Independence Day speech 2019 had highlighted that rupees 100 lakhs crore would be invested on infrastructure over the next 5 years. So based on that, the statement number one is right. If you take statement number two, the statement number two is obviously wrong. Why it is wrong? The center, state and private sector will share the capital in the basis of 39:39:22. That is central 39, state 39, private 22 formula. This is the formula. So let us see few facts related to national infrastructure pipeline. Here I have told few related points, and let us see this national infrastructure pipeline emphasis would be on ease of living, safe drinking water, access to clean, affordable energy, healthcare for all, modern railways, stations, airport, bus terminals, and world-class education institutes. This NIP will enable a forward outlook of infrastructure projects, which will create jobs, improve ease of living, and provide equitable access to the infrastructure for all, thereby making growth more inclusive. This NIP includes economic and social infrastructure projects. So these are the few important facts. And also one has to know that it has outlined plan to invest more than rupees 102 lakh crores of infrastructure project by 2024-25 with center and state private sector with the share capital expenditure in 39%, 39%, 22% formula. During this fiscal 2022-2025, the sectors, that is energy sector 24%, road 19%, urban 16%, railways 13%. One has to note that infrastructure, this NIP, is more on energy sector. So kindly know this fact related to prelims perspective. So based on this discussion, the answer for the question number is A. One only is the answer for question number 5. Let us move on with the question number 6. Government recently proposed changes in the definition of non-resident Indians for purpose of taxation. In this context, which of the following countries are the largest contributor of remittance to India in decreasing order? We have to identify in the decreasing order. If you take in a decreasing order, UAE, US, Saudi Arabia and Qatar, this is in the decreasing order. Therefore, answer for the question number 6 is D, 1, 2, 3, 4. Let us see. Contributors of remittance to India, that is, changes in definition of tax residences under the proposed changes in budget 2020. An Indian citizen who is not liable to be taxed in any other country or territory shall be deemed to be resident in India. Here, the India will have taxation rights. That is, the way the amendment to the act is word suggested that NRI, that is non-resident Indians working in countries with no income tax liabilities, will have to pay the tax in India. And also, it will be taxed only when the income is derived from the Indian business or proportion. What is the objective of this? The intent to plug a gap that leaves the Indian income of an NRI out of the tax net. So this is the few important facts related to this question. Let us move on with question number 7. Here, which of the following statement is all or correct regarding Bhima Korigan battle? So this is important. You may expect a question based on this topic for the prelims 2021. Let us see few facts related to this. This Bhima Korigan battle, that is Magar and other backward classes from Maharashtra and other parts of the country organized at Bhima Korigan every year on January 1 to commemorate 200 years of courage and sacrifice of their ancestor. With courage and sacrifice, it is a place which has been mediated by competing narratives of Dalit assertion against Brahminical oppression and Indian national standing up to the colonial army of the East Indian Company during the Battle of Bhima Korigan on January 1, 1818. The battle has come to seen as the symbol of Dalit pride. Hence, it has been celebrated by the Dalit over the years. So, let us move on with the statement. The battle took place when the forces of Maratha ruler Peshawar Bajirao II fought with those of the French army. No, this statement is wrong. Just now we discussed that it is against British East Indian Company. That is, this battle took place when the forces of Maratha ruler Peshawar Bajirao II fought with those of the British East Indian Company, not with the French army. Therefore, statement number 1 is wrong. Let us see about statement number 2. Yes, this statement is right. This is named so for being situated on the banks of River Bhima. Therefore, answer for the question number 7 is 2 only. Let us move on with question number 8. Which of the following statement is or are correct regarding Sanasat Adas Grama Yojana? Statement number 1. Under the Yojana, members of parliament are responsible for developing the socio-economic and physical infrastructure of 3 villages each. Statement number 2. The nominated MPs choose a Grama Panchayat for the rural area of the district in which their name belong in the electoral roll of the country. Here we have to identify the correct statement. Let us see about a few facts related to this Sanatat Adash Grama Yojana. The scheme was launched by the Prime Minister of India during 2014 on the birthday anniversary of Jai Prakash Narayan. Under the Yojana, the Member of Parliament are responsible for developing the socio-economic and physical infrastructure of 3 villages. So, based on that, statement number 1 is right. And if you take the Grama Panchayat, the basic unit for development, Lok Sabha, MP chooses a Grama Panchayat from within its or constituency. Rajya Sabha MP chooses Grama Panchayat from the rural area of a district of his or choice in the state from which he or she is elected. While coming with the nominated MPs, choose a Grama Panchayat from the rural area of any district in the country. So, the statement number 2 is wrong, since here it is given as with their names belongs in the electoral roll of the country. So, therefore, this statement is obviously wrong. They can choose a Grama Panchayat from the rural area of any district in the country. So, based on the discussion, answer for this question is A. 1 only is right answer. Let us move on with the question number 9. Consider the following statement regarding Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya. Statement number 1. He founded the Banaras University, Hindu University, in 1916. Statement number 2. He is also remembered for his role in ending the Indian indenture system. Here we have to identify the correct statement. So, if you take the statements regarding with Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya, both the statements are right. So, based on our discussion, answer is C, 1 and 2. Let us see few facts related to this. The Prime Minister of India paid tribute to Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya on his 158th birthday anniversary during 2019. And here this Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya, born on 25th December 1861 in Allahabad, in Uttar Pradesh. The Malviya played a key role in the Indian independence struggle against British rule and founded the Banaras Hindu University in 1916. So that is important fact. And also, he is also remembered for his role in ending the Indian indenture system, especially in the Caribbean. And also, one has to note that he popularized the term Satyamade Jayadev. However, the phrase originally belongs to the Mukunda Upanishad. The term now is the national motto of India. And he helped establishment of the Hindu Mahasabha, that is Great Society of Hindus, in 1906, which brought diverse local Hindu nationalist movement together. So here, after that, he died in 12th November 1946 at the age of 84. In 2014, he was awarded a Bharat Ratna, the country's highest civilian award. So this is the facts, few facts related to this question. Let us move on with question number 10. Which of the following statement is or are correct regarding the report titled World Economic League Table 2020? Statement number 1, it was released by the World Economic Forum. No, this statement is wrong, since it was released by Center for Economics and Business Research. In short, CEBR. Center for Economics and Business Research. Therefore, you can eliminate A and C. Let us see about statement number 2. According to it, India will overtake Germany to become fourth largest economy in the world by the year 2026. Yes, this statement is right. So, answer for the question number 10 is B, 2 only. Let us see about World Economic League Table. The report titled World Economic League Title 2020 was released by CEBR. And also, this statement 2 is right. India will overtake Germany to become fourth largest country in the economy in the world by the year 2026. India is all set to overtake the Japan to become the third largest economy by 2034. So these are the facts related to this. And let us see about CEBR. This CEBR provides independent economic forecasting to first hundreds of public and private organizations. It was founded in 1960 as Bureau of Business Research. The headquarters of the organization is located in Indiana, Munich. It is noted that in 2011, the organization predicted India to become fifth largest economy in the world by 2020, which Indians has already achieved in 2019. So these are the facts related to this question. Let us move on with question number 11. Which of the following statement regarding good governance index is correct? We have to identify the correct statement. The Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs has launched the good governance index. Number 2, the objective of GGI, that is good governance index, are to provide quantifiable data to compare the states of the governance in all the states and union territories. Here we have to identify the correct statement. The first statement is obviously wrong. Why it is wrong? The Ministry of Personnel, Public Grievances and Pension has launched the Good Governance Index. Therefore, you can eliminate A and C. So, if you take statement number 2, yes, this statement is correct. The objective of GGI are to provide quantifiable data to compare the state of governance in all the states and union territory. Therefore, option number 2, B, 2 only is right. Let us see good governance index. So it is based on the transparent, responsive, equitable and inclusive, accountable, effective, efficient, follow the rules of law, participatory and conscience of oriented. So these are the things considered for the good governance. And also, this is a uniform tool across the state to assess the status of governance and impact of various interventions taken by the state government and union territories. The 10 governance sectors are measured on total 50 indicators, and also the various principles has been kept in mind while selecting the indicators. That is, it should be easy to understand and calculate citizenship and citizen-centric and result-driven, leading to improved result and applicable to all the states, union territories, among others. And also, the state and union territories are divided into three groups, that is big states, northeast and hill states, and union territories. So these are the few important facts related to this question. Let us move on with question number 12. Consider the following statement. The centralized access control system projects aim to share information in smart cities, complex ecosystem, and combine it with contextual data that is analyzed in real time. Statement number 2, that EBCAS project aims to achieve a paperless office under e-governance initiative of Indian government. Statement number 3, this CACS and EBCAS are projected launched by the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs. Here one has to know that we have to identify the incorrect statement here. Kindly note that we have to identify the incorrect statement. If you take statement number 1, the statement is incorrect. Why incorrect? Since this project aimed to enhance security and ease of doing of business at airport, not for the information in the smart cities. Therefore, statement number 1 is wrong. If you take statement number 2, the statement number 2 is right. Why it is right? This EBCAS project aims to achieve a paperless office under e-governance initiative of Indian government. This statement is right. Therefore, you can eliminate D and B. So if you take statement number 3, this statement number 3 is wrong. Why it is wrong? Since it is incorrect, because the project are launched by the Ministry of Civil Aviation. Ministry of Civil Aviation. Therefore, this statement is also wrong. We have to identify the incorrect statement. 1 and 3 are the incorrect. The answer for the question number 12 is A, 1 and 3 only. Let us move on with question number 13. Recently, Andhra Pradesh government decided to abolish the Legislative Council in the state. In this regard, consider the following statement. The size of the Legislative Council depends upon the size of the assembly of the concerned state. Statement number 2. The Act of Parliament under Article, in short, I have given you as A. Article 169 is not deemed to be an amendment for the purpose of Article 368 of the Constitution. Unlike Rajya Sabha, Legislative Councils do not have substantial power to shape financial legislations. Here we have to identify the correct statement. Let us see the statement one by one. Here, if you take statement number 3, obviously the statement is wrong. Why it is wrong? Since both Rajya Sabha and Legislative Council do not have powers in financial matters, both including Rajya Sabha. Here it is given as unlike Rajya Sabha. Therefore, this statement is wrong. Therefore, you can eliminate D, C, B. Therefore, answer, you are deriving the answer in the straight away. That is 1 and 2 only is the correct answer. So, anyhow, let us see few facts related to this question. That is Legislative Council. Here, recently, the Andhra Pradesh Legislative Council is all too set to be abolished in a major move. That is, Chief Minister Y.S. Jagmohan Reddy has moved a statutory resolution in the Legislative Assembly seeking the abolition of the Legislative Council, which is dominated by the opposition Telugu Desam Party. Just as Parliament has two houses, so that the state, if they chooses to, at the state level, the equivalent of the Lok Sabha is Vidhan Sabha, that is called as Legislative Assembly, and that of Rajya Sabha is also called as Vidhan Parishad, that is Legislative Council. The opinion in the Constituent Assembly was divided on the idea, that is, among the arguments in its favor, the second house can help check actions by the directly elected house and also enable non-elected individuals to contribute to the legislative process. And also one has to note that this Act of Parliament is not deemed to be amendment of the Constitution for the purpose of Article 368 and is passed like a ordinary piece of legislation. That is, this Act can be passed by a simple majority. And unlike Rajya Sabha, which has substantial power to shape non-financial legislation, not a financial legislations. That is, this Legislative Council lacks a constitutional mandate to do so. This assembly can override suggestions and amendments made to the legislation by the council. So these are the few important facts related to this question. So let us move on with the question number 14. National Company Appellate Law Tribunal can be appeals against order passed by which of the following? So this is very important question. You can expect a question this year also. Let us see. National Company Appellate Law Tribunal. Yes, we have to choose the correct answer for this question. Let us see. This National Company Appellate Law Tribunal can hear appeals against order passed by National Company Law Tribunal, yes. Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India, yes. And also one has to note that it is this NCLAT, that is National Company Appellate Law Tribunal, can hear appeals from Competitive Commission of India also. So all the statements are correct. Answer for this question is 1, 2 and 3. Let us see a few facts related to this National Company Appellate Law Tribunal. National Company Law Tribunal is also the appellate tribunal for hearing appeals against the orders passed by NCLT under Section 61 of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016, in short IBC. This NCLAT is also an appellate tribunal for hearing appeals against the order passed by the IBC under the Section 202 and Section 211. Under also one has to note that NCLAT is also appellate tribunal to hear and dispose of appeals against any directions and decisions made or order passed by the Competitive Commission of India. These 3 points are very important, so kindly make note of it. Let us move on with question number 15. Here we have to identify the correct statement regarding with the Hilu proclamations of UNESCO seen in the news recently. This is related to B, the promotion of linguistic diversity to improve social diversity. Kindly note down the word Hilu proclamation of UNESCO, that is for promotion of linguistic diversity to promote social diversity. Why it is in the news? Since the Tulu language, there has been growing demand to include Tulu in the 8th schedule of the Constitution. At present, Tulu is not an official language in India or any other country. So one has to note this declaration. India has a lot to learn from the Hilu proclamations. Placing of all the deserving languages on equal footing with promote social inclusions and national solidarity. It will reduce the inequalities with the country to a great extent. What is the objective of this proclamation? Let us see. Made by the UNESCO, the People's Republic of China in 2018 says, the protection and promotion of linguistic diversity helps to improve social inclusion and partnership. So kindly note that and know more important facts about this Hulu proclamation of UNESCO. Let us move on with question number 16. So here, which of the following statement regarding to the Asia Pacific Drosophila Research Conference? It is the biennial conference that promote interaction of Drosophila researchers. Yes, this statement is correct. What about statement number 2? This is the most important widely used organism for biological research, as its genome in entire sequence. And also India recently organized the conference for the first time. Yes, all the given 3 statements are correct. Answer for the question number 16 is D, 1, 2, 3. Let us see few facts related to this question. The Asia Pacific Drosophila Research Conference or biennial event, that is 2 years once, that aims to promote the interaction of Drosophila researchers in the Asia Pacific region with their peers in the rest of the world. The 5th edition of the Asia Pacific Drosophila Research Conference is being held at Pune in India. Kindly note that the conference is being organized in the country for the first time by the Indian Institute of Science, Education and Research, in short IISER. And also the last 4 editions of this conference took places of Seoul, Taipei, Beijing and Osaka. This Drosophila, that is fruit fly, is one of the most widely used and preferred model organism in biological research across the world for the last 100 years. Several discoveries in biologicals have been made using this. Its genome is entirely sequenced and there is enormous information available about its biochemistry, physiology and behavior. So these are the important facts related to this question. Let us move on with the question number 17. With reference to the various initiatives dealing with the cyber crimes in India, consider the following statement. Statement number 1. Cyber Safe Women initiative of Ministry of Women and Development and Child Development aim to spread awareness against atrocities committed against children and women through cyberspace. Statement number 2. Cyber Crime Prevention Against Women and Children Scheme of Ministry of Home Affairs aim to have an effective mechanism to handle cyber crimes against women and children. Statement number 3. Cyber Dose is a Twitter handle launched by the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology to spread awareness about cyber crimes. Here we have to identify the correct statement. Before that, let us know about Cyber Safe Women Initiative. The Maharashtra government has launched a Cyber Safe Women Initiative to educate women about how the web is used by the anti-social element and child predators to commit various type of crimes. And also it aims to create awareness on the cyberspace in light of the increasing number of cases where women and children are targeted. This initiative was launched in 34 districts and 90 places across the Maharashtra at all once. It will help in educating women. Kindly note the word educating women about how the web is used by antisocial elements and child predators to commit various type of crimes. So this is the main aim of that. Therefore, statement number 1 is wrong. Let us move on with statement number 2. That is Cyber Crime Prevention Against Women and Children Scheme. The main objective of this scheme is to have an effective mechanism to handle cyber crimes against women and children in the country. So this scheme was launched by the Home Affairs. It is not by the Ministry of Electronics and Information. Therefore, statement number 3 is wrong, you can eliminate. D, C, 1 is also wrong, right? Therefore, you can eliminate A also. Therefore, answer for the question is B, 2 only is the right answer. So, let us see few facts also. What are the main features of the scheme? Online cybercrime reporting platforms and also one national level cyber forensic laboratory, training of police officers, judges, prosecutors and cybercrime awareness activities, research and development. So these are the important facts. Other initiatives dealing with the cybercrimes are that is Union Ministry of Union Ministry of Home Affairs has launched the Twitter account. So not the Ministry of Electronics and Information. So one has to note statement number 2 is correct based on our discussion. Let us move on with the question number 18. Consider the following statement regarding coal sector in India. So this is very very important question. Let us see, you can expect a question from coal this year prelims 2021. In India, companies that do not have coal mines operation in India can also participate in coal block auction. Statement number 2, India's coal reserves are available only for the captive use of steel and power industry. Here we have to identify the correct statement. Yes, the statement number 1 is correct. Recently, the coal block bidding, the government plans to promote foreign direct investment in the sector by removing end-use restrictions and eligibility criteria for partition in coal block auction. It would allow companies that do not have coal mine operation in India to also participate in coal block auctions. Previously, there was a restriction that anybody to participate should have the coal mine operation in India. But now it has been changed. It has been relaxed. So what about statement number 2? This statement number 2 is wrong, since the government recently decided to remove end-use restriction in order to promote FDI in the sector, not for the Indian coal reserves are available only to the captive use of steel and power industries. That is not the objective. The government recently decided to remove end-use restriction in order to promote foreign direct investment in the sector. So that is the discussion about this question. Let us move on with question number 19. Consider the following statement. Statement number 1. India recently organized the first international symposium on marine ecosystem. Statement number 2. Marine Biological Association of India aims to promote research on marine sciences in the Asia-Pacific region. Here we have to identify the correct statement. Let us see. If you take this marine ecosystem, India recently organized the third international symposium on marine ecosystem. That is the global meet on marine ecosystem. The eminent marine scientists, oceanographers, fishery researchers and marine biotechnologists assembled in Kochi to attend the third international symposium on marine ecosystem challenges and opportunities. Not the first. Therefore, the statement number 1 is wrong. You can eliminate A and C. And if you take statement number 2, yes, this statement is correct. Just now we have discussed. Let us see. Organized by the Marine Biological Association of India to set a platform for discussion of a wide range of topics including impact of climate change on marine ecosystem and unusual warming of the Arabian Sea. So this is the 4-day meet held at the Central Marine Fisheries Research Institute. It assumes significance in the backdrop of recent trends of continuous cyclonic storms and other phenomena in the Arabian Sea. During a special section of the climate crisis, experts discussed blue carbon habitats, ocean acidifications, sea surface temperature, ocean warming, extreme events, climate, smart technologies and carbon footprints, impact and mitigations and vulnerability of climate change also. So these are the few important facts related to question number 19. See, one has to go through Marine Biological Association of India also. That is also very important for the prelims perspective. Let us move on with the question number 20. The Global Talent Competitiveness Index, that is annual benchmarking report, is published by which of the following? Indian School of Business, INSEAD, World Economic Forum, World Forum. It is a straight answer. If you know, if you came across Global Talent Competitiveness Index, that is based on INSEAD. So answer for the question is B, INSEAD. Let us move on with question number 21. You consider the following statement regarding Lala Lajpat Rai. So this is very important. You may expect a question in terms of modern history also based on this. Let us discuss about few facts related to Lala Lajpat Rai, and then we will discuss about the statement. So this Lala Lajpat Rai was the prominent nationalist leader who played an important role in India's struggle for freedom. And also, his brand of patriotism and potent vocalism against the British rule earned him the title of Punjab Keshari or the Lion of the Punjab. He also initiated the foundation of Punjab National Bank. Lala Lajpat Rai was a reader, and everything he read left a great imprint and imprint on his mind. He was deeply impressed by the ideals of patriotism and nationalism outlined by the Italian revolutionary leader Mazzini, and inspired by Mazzini, the Lalaji became indoctrinated into the revolutionary way of attaining freedoms. He, together with the other prominent leaders like Bipin Chandra Pal, Aurobindo Ghosh from Bengal and Bala Gangadhar Tilak from Maharashtra, began to see the negative aspect of moderate politics advocated by the many leaders of the Indian National Congress. He went to the British in 1914 and then to the USA in 1917. In October 1917, he founded the Indian Home Rule League of America in New York. He stayed in USA from 1917 to 1920. In 1920, after return from America, Lala Lajpat Rai was invited to preside over the special section of the Congress in Calcutta. He was the first president of All India Trade Union Congress, which led to the trade union movement. He was initially not in favor of the policy of non-cooperation. He was against the boycott of schools, but later he supported the movement. In fact, he protested against its withdrawal in 1922. His proposal for a clear partition of India into Muslim India, non-Muslim India, on December 14, 1924, in the tribune and met with the major controversy. In 1928, the British government set up a commission and no Indians was named in the list. Lala Lajpat Rai led to the silent march in protest and returned. The British police declared a literary charge where Lala Lajpat Rai was assaulted and injured. He died on the November 17, 1928 due to his serious injuries, and his death is celebrated as Martyrs Day in Odisha. So let us see the facts. He founded the Indian Home Rule League of America in New York. Yes, based on our discussion, this statement is right. He never presided over any section of the Indian National Congress. No. Just now we have discussed. He presided the Indian National Congress after his return from America. That is special section of the Congress in Calcutta. Therefore, statement number 2 is wrong. You can eliminate D and B. What about statement number 3? This is wrong. Since we have just now we have discussed it did. It is celebrated as Mattress Day of in Odisha. It's not in Punjab. Therefore, statement number 3 is wrong. You can eliminate C also. The obviously answer for the question would be 1 and 4 only. That is A. He proposes partition of India into Muslim India, non-Muslim India. Just now we have discussed. These are the few important facts related to this question. Let us move on with question number 22. Which of the following statement regarding Pradhan Mantri Kishan Samman Nidhi PM, that is PM Kishan scheme is or are correct? If you analyze the previous question paper, that is 2020, there was a question related to this scheme. So you may expect a question from the government schemes. Let us see the statements. It is the central sector scheme with 100% funding from central government. Yes. This is correct statement. 100%, that is central sector scheme. What about statement number 2? Land holding in the sole criteria to avail the benefits of the scheme. Yes. Land holding is the sole criteria. And then there is no distinction between rural and urban cultivatable land under this scheme. Yes. This is also correct. All the statements given are correct. So answer for the question is D, 1, 2 and 3. Let us see about this Pradhan Mantri Kishan Samman Nidhi, PM Kishan, under the government scheme playlist. Kindly go through that and one has to know the more information about that. Let us see with question number 23. That is Baba Kalyani Committee was a setup to what are the following? So let us see. Draft a new model police act. B. Recommend amendments to the criminal law and study the existing SEZ policy of India and review domestic protection profile of oil and gas. So here one has to note we have to check about Baba Kalyani Committee. The answer for the question is straightforward. If you know about the scheme about SEZ, this is very important. Kindly note down. So let us see. This Baba Kalyani Committee was constituted by the Ministry of Commerce and Industries to study the existing SEZ policy of India. The objective of the committee was to evaluate the SEZ policies and make it and WTO compatible, suggest measures for maximizing and utilization for the vacant land in SEZ. And also, what are the recommendations? Framework shift from export growth to broad-based employment and economic growth and formalization of separate rules and procedures for manufacturing and servicing. What do you mean by SEZ? Special Economic Zone. Kindly note the word. SEZ is nothing but Special Economic Zone. And also, it recommended enhanced competitiveness by enabling ecosystem development by funding high-speed multimodal connectivity, business service, etc. So these are the few important facts related to this question. Let us move on with question number 24. So this is the environmental question. Consider the following statement. The bio rock is formed by electro accumulation of minerals dissolved in seawater on steel structure that are connected to a power source. Yes, correct. What about statement number 2? Bio rock is a mineral accretion technology that can be used to restore coral reef. Yes, this statement is also correct. So answer for the question is C, both 1 and 2. So let us see few facts related to bio rock or mineral accretion technology. That is, ZSI Zoological Survey of India, with the help from Gujarat Forest Department, is attempting for the first time a process for restore coral reef using bio rock or mineral accretion technique. So this bio rock is the name given to the substance formed by the electro accumulation of minerals dissolved in seawater on steel structures that are lowered on the seabed and are connected to the power source. In this case, solar panels that float on the surface. This technology works by passing a small amount of electrical current to the electrodes in the water. When a positively charged anode and a negatively charged cathode are placed on the seawater with an electric current flowing between them, the calcium ions combine with carbonate ions and adhere to the structure that is cathode. This results in calcium carbonate formation and the coral rod adhere to the CaCO3 and grow quickly. So that is the objective. The fragments of broken corals are tied to the bio rock structure where they are stable, that is able to grow at least 4 to 6 times faster than their actual growth, as they need not spend their energy in building their own calcium carbonate skeletons. So these are the facts related to bio rocks. Let us move on with question number 25, the last question of today's discussion. So this is very important question related to current affairs and also static and related to polity also. Let us see, with reference to the Disaster Management of Act of 2005, consider the following statement. The Act mandated the creation of National and State Disaster Management Authority only. No, this statement is wrong. Why? District authority also included. That is, District Disaster Management Authorities also included. This act mandated the creation of the National Disaster Management Authority and Disaster Management Authority of States and District Disaster Management Authority. Therefore, statement number 1 is wrong. Obviously, A and C are eliminated. Let us see about statement number 2. The main drawback of the present policy is it neglects long-term recovery. Yes, this statement is right, since it neglects the long-term recovery. So let us see. And also, one has to go through this NDMA Act of 2005. This is very important. Let us see the few facts related to this proposal. The proposal to the amendment, that is Disaster Management Act of 2005. The present act largely focuses on improving preparedness, providing immediate relief, protecting infrastructure. The main drawback of the present policy, it neglects the long-term recovery. That is the main drawback. So the brief about Disaster Management Act 2005, kindly go through that. So those things are very important related to your prelims perspective. Due to the time constraint, we are not discussing it. We will discuss about Disaster Management Act of 2005 separately. So with this, we are concluding this discussion. Thanks for being with this online discussion. So hope we'll meet in the next class. Have a good day. Thank you all.